It began in the cold of winter and ended in the warmth of spring. In between, the 1998 Santa Anita season was defined by the champions who endured the unpredictable elements to find sanctuary in the winner's circle. Champions wrapped in silver, exotic island girls, and a quiet competitor who would make Triple Crown noise. The historic proportion of the El Nino rains were eclipsed only by the competitors who called Santa Anita home. Once again, America's top horses, trainers, jockeys, and owners took their rightful place among the legends who, for more than six decades, have made Santa Anita the great race place. We had the privilege of bringing you their stories through our television shows, Santa Anita Today on Fox Sports Net and Inside Santa Anita on Fox Sports Net and KDOC. Everyone involved in racing will have a different definition of the best moments of Santa Anita's 1998 season. These are some of ours. In the four-year-old Colts division, there simply was no other horse that created as much admiration as last year's Kentucky Derby and Preakness winner Silver Charm. The Silver Gauntlet was thrown. It's the day after Christmas, and all through the malls, the sound of great returns echo in the halls. But at Santa Anita Park, it's a welcome sound we hear. Great racing's returned, as it has this day for 60 years. Seabiscuit, Roundtable, Affirmed, and The Bid. The great ones have raced here since we were kids. Today is no different. A Kentucky Derby champ is back. It's been six long months since Silver Charm has raced under tack. Will he begin a streak that could end as Horse of the Year? One thing is certain, the answer soon will be clear. Santa Anita Today and Fox Sportsnet bring you the fun. The Grade 1 Malibu Stakes is about to be run. Last spring, Silver Charm was the answer to racing's prayers. In five short weeks, the Colts' gutty Triple Crown wins bounced him off the racing pages and onto the front pages of newspapers around the country. But time doesn't wait for any man, nor does it wait for any horse. It was only 6 months ago that Silver Charm impressed the racing world by winning two-thirds of the Triple Crown, missing racing's Holy Grail by less than two lengths. But his name was seldom mentioned when balloting began for Horse of the Year honors.
A lot of people have forgotten how great a horse this horse is. You know, that's the problem with racing. It's what have you done for me lately?
They may have forgotten how good Silver Charm was on the track, but they haven't forgotten Baffert.
Everywhere I go, even during Christmas shopping, people come up to me and they'll say, I know you from somewhere, you know, do I know you? And I go, no, I don't think so. And I said, and finally they'll go, are you involved with horses, race horses? And right away they catch on.
And this particular race could shake their memory. Unraced since June when he was sidelined by a fever brought on by his hard campaign, Silver Charm used the time to grow physically. In the words of his trainer, from a boy to a man. Mentally, however, the gray has always had the maturity of an old soul.
I have never had a horse, been around a horse, quarter horse or thoroughbred, that has been so laid back as this horse. He never gets excited. He never gets hot. His mind is just unbelievable. You know, you get to thinking to yourself, boy, he either has 104 temperature or that's just the way he is, but that's the way he is. You know, we're constantly taking his temperature because he's just so quiet and laid back. If you're going to be vulnerable, it's going to be in the Malibu problem. If he's going to win, it's going to be a lot up to him because he has the heart, the class, and the desire to do it. If he gets a clean trip, he'll get the job done.
And if he does get the job done, people could be hard-pressed to forget about Silver Charm in 1998.
Silver Charm, let's see now. Gary Stevens starting to ask him. He's got the white cap, looking for somewhere to run. Silver Charm, can he split horses? Nowhere to go. Here's Lord Griot coming like an express train on the outside. And Lord Griot, now Silver Charm gets out. And Silver Charm tries to come back. They run down to the wire. And Lord Griot has won it ahead from an unlucky Silver Charm.
Silver Charm is the star of racing right now, so an unknown colt from Argentina raised just slight to moderate interest going into the Malibu Stakes. But Lord Griot hasn't had a bad race yet in his short career. In fact, he won Argentina's equivalent of our Breeders' Cup Juvenile as a two-year-old, and he has three wins and two seconds in just five starts. But opening day, he proved to be the monster working far back in the Malibu field, ready to chomp the charm.
All I've heard from everybody is that we were lucky to win, that the other horse had all the trouble, you know, and there's a lot of truth to it, but there's also a different side to every story.
Lord Brio's story includes racing 5 wide, coming from behind a moderate pace, and being 7 months younger than his American peers.
He didn't switch leads till very late. He switched hard. He kind of dropped his head a little bit in the stretch when he did. He got caught up in the adrenaline of the race himself with the big move and getting into the race and moving by all those horses in a surge. Here again, you're talking about a horse that comes home in 22 and change, and you just can't take anything away. I know it's a better race, and I know it's a close race, and maybe even a different outcome if the other horse don't have trouble, but we sure did a lot of things in the wrong direction that favored that we should have had no shot to win that race. Silver Charm won't be our focus of what we have to do to get to this series, to be peaking on the mile and a quarter, meaning, of course, the big cap. That's when I'd like to see this horse come to his best race.
Gary Stevens ended up in the winner's circle doing an interview after the Malibu Stakes, but it wasn't the kind he had planned.
Bob. Alongside Gary Stevens. Gary, this horse broke.
If it is possible to be pleased with the loss, Stevens was ecstatic with Silver Charm's performance.
He's a great racehorse, and I've got to think that with the added age and maturity, he's just he's going to be one of the best that I've ever sat on. Anytime they're coming off that kind of a layoff and they're as good a horse as Silver Charm is, you just keep your fingers crossed that they're going to come back as good as they were before. And he showed me that he's probably a little better than what he was in the spring of 1997.
Silver Charm was a marked horse in the Malibu, hopelessly boxed in behind horses for most of the race, waiting for racing room. It was an exercise in frustration for his partner.
Like being in rush hour traffic and you're driving a Ferrari and you got 2 Volkswagens in front of you, and there's nothing that you can do. You can't sprout wings and fly over the top of them, and I'm riding a horse that's worth $7 million, and I'm not going to jeopardize his safety by trying to bounce his way out like bumper cars. I had a chance to bump Mud Rat out at the head of the stretch, but you know, I don't care if it's $1 million horse or a $10,000 horse. These horses are my life, and I got to come back and ride them in a couple of weeks. And this horse is more than my life. He could be all a thoroughbred horse racing's mainstay over the next couple of years. And I'd just like to see him stay healthy and stay competitive and get the sport back involved again.
Silver Charm's national following is based partly on his remarkable will to win and the ability to fight until the very end.
I don't know if that can be taught. I don't believe it can be taught. I think it's just he's a very intelligent horse. He seems to know where the finish line is, and he knows he's supposed to win.
While time is significant in racing, never it is more important than the official workouts in the daily racing form. These minutes and seconds indicate a horse's fitness and training pattern, and the official clockers who record the workouts spend the wee hours of the morning systematically turning what they see into the numbers we see.
Perched on the end of the press box, Chuck Russell and his crew scan the racetrack, differentiating workers amongst the hundreds of gallopers. The real difficulty comes, however, when horsemen line up after a break in the action to train on the freshly harrowed surface.
Like after the break, especially after you have a rain, you get like maybe 150 horses working 15 minutes, then it's tough.
Your strategy is a minute and 3 cuffs.
Yeah, how about the back five?
I'll get the back one.
No,
no, they're all covered?
Okay.
You got the very front team, Denny?
Yeah, I got the front.
How about the team at the half? Are they...
Horsemen must report the names and distances of their workers to the clocker located at the gap.
Okay, I got Silver Charm.
How far?
5/8.
Okay.
Shot of gold.
Pisces was working Bravo Lover and Secondi.
The challenge is matching the horses they see on the track with the names listed.
Well, I do it with computer. Most of the guys do it in a book. They have the bays with no marks in one section, the bays with stars and stuff in another section, chestnuts in another one, and grays in another one, so it's really easy to find them.
But with so many horses working at once, a seemingly insurmountable task falls into order with their aggressive approach.
The first one who sees them, they'll say, I'll get the half, or I'll get the three-quarter pole, and that's it. And a lot of times, when it gets real busy, that's the hardest part of the whole job, is knowing who has who.
And each clocker usually times several horses at once, using splits. Complicated? Yes. But the clockers control something most people constantly battle.
If everybody just worked on their own, didn't say anything, I mean, it'd be complete chaos, you know, as you know, because you see a lot of horses running, and everybody says who they have, you have to work together on this job. Have to.
Silver Charm right up alongside, six lengths back to Lord Griot. Through the stretch they come, Mud Road at the rail, but Silver Charm not to be denied. He's sticking his neck out and coming home like a true champion. Silver Charm, Mud Road, ultra game on his inside, but the class of Silver Charm will prevail, and Silver Charm wins the San Fernando from Mud Road.
Is Silver Charm as good as he was when he dominated last spring's Triple Crown races? His detractors point to the one-length margin of victory in the San Fernando over a horse who has never won a stakes race. But his biggest supporter argues Silver Charm has never won a race by as much as two lengths.
I had to work for it, you know, we had to work for it. And I think with Silver Charm, that's the way it's always going to be. He's not one of these horses that's just going to leave the field and destroy him, because that's the way he is, you know. He's always make the other guy think, well, maybe next time I'll get him, but that's not the case with him.
So just how good is Silver Charm?
We're just enjoying the ride. I mean, one thing about having a horse like Silver Charm, it's great. I've never had a horse where when he comes back to the winner's circle, the whole stand is cheering him. That's really a great feeling. It tells you a little bit that our sport is still alive and thriving, and the people that came out here, they got a great run.
Well, Silver Charm was one gray threat. The other was the sky.
Winter months bring both rain and changing temperatures. And with the threat of El Nino storms, the racing surface can change in seconds.
Timing is crucial to everything we do. If we get rain during the races, no matter who you are, you're in a lot of trouble, because the water gets into it and makes it uneven and makes it soft and could create injuries to the horses.
Such a soaking can be prevented by sealing or compacting the track, which pushes the air out, forcing the rain to run off the top.
The material is already at 10% moisture. But so there's a real narrow window. Minutes really matter. 5 minutes can mean the difference of getting it sealed or not. Once it turns to mud, you can't seal it. You can't compact it anymore.
But if rain strikes during the racing day, Wood's hands or tractors are tied. Luckily, however, most new storms respectfully wait until the last race of the day has run.
Tonight, after the last race, as soon as the horses head down the home stretch, you'll see an army of stuff coming out and going the wrong way, because we know we only have a little time. If it was cloudy now, I'd be neurotic already, because you don't know what it's going to do, you know, and you got to make it to 4:37 before you can do anything.
Woo! We made it!
It's a goofy job.
It is an exclusive club, perhaps the most discriminatory in racing. Only three have ever met the strict qualifications. The triumvirate is synonymous with greatness. Their names etched into racing's lore. Affirmed, Spectacular Bid, Ali Sheba. These are the Kentucky Derby winners whose transformation to immortality came when crossing the finish line first in the Stroob Stakes. For a decade, they've stood alone and unmatched. But this afternoon, they've gathered to consider expanding their group by one. Will champion Silver Charm join this hallowed fraternity? The votes are being cast as Santa Anita today and Fox Sportsnet proudly present the $500,000 Stroob Stakes next.
And away they go.
Silvercharm hesitated just momentarily. Mudrout was away very alertly, and Mudrout takes the early lead. True Story on the outside up to race in second, and Silvercharm right there in third. Kukulkan on the outside is racing in the fourth spot, and Bagshot down at the rail, and that leaves Steel Ruler last. Only seven lengths would cover the lot. They head past the 7/8, and Chris McCarron dictates the pass on Mudrout as he goes a little wide into the turn. Silvercharm now moving up on the inside, and Silvercharm right there in second. True Story on his outside, a close up third, and Kukulkan is racing fourth, then back to Bagshot in the gold colors, and Steel Ruler is six lengths off the leaders. They swing onto the backstretch in the Strube, and Chris McCarron at his all his own way here as Mudrout just taking them along by three parts of a length to True Story. Silvercharm right there in the third spot, now three lengths off the leaders. Silvercharm just lost a bit of ground here. Kukulkan has run up on his outside. Now Silvercharm recovered again and starts to close in on that leader. Then back to Bagshot, and Steel Ruler is last. They run into the far turn, and Silvercharm now taken outside of them to go and put the pressure on them, but Mudrout kicks on down at the rail, and Mudrout going to run a good one again today. He's kicking on gamely. Between horses comes True Story and Silvercharm. Here we go again. Mudrout and Silvercharm. Pulling up was True Story. Top of the lane, and Silvercharm takes the lead. Mudrout digs deep. He tries his heart out, but Silvercharm is just exuding class, and Silvercharm striding home in the Strube Stakes. He's saying, bring on, gentlemen, for the big cap. The race of the year is on the cards. Silvercharm romps in the Strube.
This horse was very impressive today, Bobby. Becomes only the fourth horse to win the Kentucky Derby and the Strube. He joins Ali Sheba, Spectacular Bid, and Affirmed. When you were a kid training horses on the Arizona Fair Circuit, did that thought ever cross your mind, you'd train a horse in that kind of company?
Well, I mean, I never dreamed of it. I was thinking of winning the All-American Futurity, you know, but I want to say hello to my dad, the chief, who's watching this right now, and this horse, he gives me goosebumps. I mean, he's just a great horse, and he just gets better and better, you know.
Were you more impressed by his win today than in the San Fernando? Did he show you more?
I knew he was going to run a bigger race today. I told Bob Lewis a couple days ago, I wish we're running against Gentleman today, because he's really doing that good. But Gentleman's a great horse. I think it's going to be a great race, the big cap.
All right, thanks a lot, Bob.
I think they should go to Dubai, though.
All right, that sounds good. Go enjoy the winner's circle, Bob.
The nature of the game often takes unexpected turns. That's what happened when the Great Gentleman came to claim the older horse division, as his stablemate Siphon had just last year.
Undefeated champion two-year-old in his native country, Siphon, the big, bold Brazilian, was sent to America in search of riches, glory, and ultimately the fairy tale ending. But the best things in life aren't free, and Siphon would have to earn his destiny. And he did, with victories like the 1997 Santa Anita Handicap.
Siphon digs deep, he finds more. Gentleman is battling his heart out to get him down at the rail, but Siphon has his measure, and it's going to be Siphon and David Flores.
He was one of those touched horses that was exceptionally good, one of a few in his whole class that could really rise to the top, and he did it and did it for a while.
Siphon's success as a top handicap horse, combined with his powerful good looks, enabled him to make the transition from racehorse to sought-after stallion at Airdrie Stud in the bluegrass of Kentucky.
Siphon arrived here and settled in very well. He likes his new home here in Kentucky, and he's taken to his job. He's about as fast in the breeding shed as he was on the racetrack.
And he'd better be, as he'll be plenty busy in his first season at Stud.
He had 90-plus mares booked to him, and people come to look at him and can't believe how good-looking he is, and the bone he has, and the big, strong, correct horse that he is. So we've already turned people down as far as this year he's full of.
If anybody that looks at him sees a muscle formation that I think is unique in the thoroughbred industry, I think he has muscles that other horses haven't thought of yet. And they're long running muscles, not short bunched up weightlifting type muscles. With it, he had a great courage and a determination to fight. And the combination of that together is what it takes to be great. And he had all of it.
Siphon's tremendous heart carried him wire to wire in the 1997 Big Cap. Now his power and speed will grace the racetrack through his offspring. His heart will go on. Trackside, I'm Carolyn Conley.
How Devil's Pal in the white sleeves, still battling on Gamely too, and Invitato Mio alongside of that is Malik in the blue cap. They come for home, and Hal's Pal is battling them all off. Hal's Pal finds more. Malik and Fleck chase him home, but it's a huge run from Hal's Pal, and Hal's Pal and Brice Blanc win the San Pascal from Malik and Fleck.
Tomorrow will mark the 1998 debut of Gentleman after a vacation that started last September. That time off came when he ran a disappointing fifth in the Woodbine Mile due to an ulcerated palate. Jay, what's a layman's term for an ulcerated palate?
I think that's a fancy way of saying he had a sore throat, Kurt. Gentleman is a consistent horse, even with that sore throat. He's got a record of 12 wins and 17 starts, so that Woodbine Mile can probably be considered an anomaly. The six-year-old Argentinian Marvel was third in last year's Big Cap, close on the heels of his stablemates Siphon and Sandpit. Tomorrow we'll see if he's a wiser gentleman.
At this stage, he's handled everything that comes up. The only day he had a bad day was in the Big Cap last year. He was forced down inside with a lot of pressure from the outside, and it kind of unrattled him. And since then, he's been in several different situations and handled them well.
One of the things that he's handled very well, and which should be an issue on Saturday, is mud.
He broke the track record at Hollywood Park and near broke the world record, so in the mud, in the Native Diver Handicap, so he can sure handle mud. I'd say he's a little bit more cooperative than he used to be. Hell, I was rambunctious when I was young, and I'm very cooperative now, so it's just a matter of time. His last important work 2 weeks ago was a mile in 1:36.1, and he galloped out a mile and eighth in 1:48.4, and he came back and didn't blow out a match. So I think he's ready to go, and I think he's as good as ever. He seems to have that look. He's got a good glow to his coat, and his eyes very sharp, and he's looking for trouble. And so that's a good sign if you're going to battle.
Ray Fernando Tom breathing down his neck. Second, Gentleman third, Dramatic Gold. Something wrong today. He didn't run at all. They come for home, and now Gentleman has let loose and he explodes. And Gentleman looking like he just jumped in at the quarter pole. Gentleman at his center, leading best today. Just look at the star. Gentleman trotting home.
From the Richard Mandela barn, the fearsome threesome that dominated last year's Big Cap were all South American imports, and this year is no different.
Part of Richard Mandela's Big Cap trio, Malik was a multiple Grade 1 winner in Chile before coming to the U.S.
He won his first race, an allowance race at Hollywood Park, and then came back and was second in the San Pasqual Handicap here at Santa Anita. After that race, the next day, cut a blood bruise out of the heel of his foot. And I'd say he probably wasn't 100% in his race, and he should do better next time. And he worked a mile in 1:37 at Hollywood Park, and finished his last 3/8 and 35 flat, so he's coming very good. I expect a lot of him. Who knows if he can beat horses like Gentleman and Silver Charm until you actually try them. And you can guess all you want. Even workouts in the morning wouldn't be conclusive. You just have to throw them in there together and see what happens. For $1 million, it's look and see. We're looking hard.
You know, with all the hype and publicity surrounding this year's Big Cap, a friend of mine did recently ask me if all the previous Big Cap winners were placed in one race, who would win? Of course, I said that's a tough question. A lot would depend on post position. I mean, after all, you wouldn't want to pick a horse that drew post number 60, now would you? However, all things being equal, I've come up with what I consider to be the best three Santa Anita Handicap winners of all time. And the list does not include Vigors, Best Pal, Roundtable, John Henry, or Ali Shiva. I'm just going to assume that they had traffic trouble. So who among the 60 previous Big Cap winners would hit the board in this mythical race? Well, take them in reverse order from show to place to win.
He was a horse who was so popular, his fabled career actually inspired a full-length Hollywood-produced motion picture. It's always difficult to compare horses from different eras, but Seabiscuit was a legend in his own time. In 1940, at age 7 and carrying 130 pounds, the Biscuit became the world's richest thoroughbred of all time by winning the Big Cap in his third attempt. For second money, we'll take Affirm, the 1978 Triple Crown winner, and victorious in the Big Cap the following year. Affirmed only ran fast when he had to, and his final time of 1:58.3 remains the fastest big cap of all time.
Down the stretch they come. Affirmed has the lead by five. Tiller on the outside second. It's Affirmed in front, and Affirmed wins the big cap by four lengths.
But the winner of this mythical big cap race for the ages would be the greatest horse ever to look through a bridle. Those were the words of trainer Buddy Delp about three-time champion and Horse of the Year Spectacular Bid. And you know something? He may not have been too far wrong. The 1980 Big Cap was contested in heavy rains over a sloppy track, but neither the elements nor 130 pounds could stop Spectacular Bid.
A 16th of a mile to go. The Bid in front by three, and Spectacular Bid winning the Big Cap.
Jockey Gary Stevens rode Gentleman to victory in the San Antonio and won the Stroob aboard Silver Charm later that very same day. Stevens called picking his big cap mount the toughest decision of his career. He chose Silver Charm. And yesterday he found out that he'll watch the race from the jockey's room while Pat Day rides Gentleman.
It's not only devastating to me, but the whole race in public. Everybody was really anticipating this race, including myself. I just feel worse for Mr. and Mrs. Lewis. I know they're very disappointed. Bob Baffert's disappointed. Santa Anita, it's a big blow. And we were all looking forward to the matchup tomorrow. And, we'll meet later on down the road. They tell me that the horse is going to be fine. It's a situation where he could be fine tomorrow, but you don't risk a horse like this if they're not 100% the day before a race. But, he's going to go on. He's going to give us more opportunities for these big purses. And just keep my fingers crossed that he's all right.
It was one of those things where we didn't want to risk it. So I had to make the call, the veterinarians. I brought another second veterinarian in there. And he thought maybe by tomorrow, it could be all right, but you don't know. So we just didn't want to let anybody hang up. So I decided just not run the horse and just take care of him. And unfortunately for Sandy and everybody, it's a big blow, for the fans and everybody. But we got to take care of our stars. And so that basically we're just taking care of the Charm. He'll be back.
Maybe Pat will feel bad for me and decide to let me ride tomorrow. I don't know. But I may help him out if he asked for it, but by the same token, I don't want to do anything to jeopardize me possibly not getting back on the horse should he get beat. But I'm rooting for Gentleman tomorrow, and if Pat needs any help, then I'll be more than willing to give it to him.
For the Santa Anita handicap sent on their way. They all came out well. Gentleman began perfectly, and Gentleman just pricks his ears and goes off to lead them early. It's like he's taking a look at these birds as he comes by. Now they take off, and he's quite happy as Gentleman just settles down on the lead. Malik has now moved through on the inside of him, and Bagshot just right on the heels of Gentleman. And the long shot Don't Blame Rio, content to drop back early. He's last six off the leaders. Past the stands first time round, and Malik on the inside. Not in any hurry at all. Malik just going along as slow as he can, and Gentleman is right up alongside of him. Bagshot getting a little tap on the shoulder to keep company with those first two, and then there's a gap of four lengths back to Don't Blame Rio. They head to the three-quarter pole, and it's the Dick Mandela pair of Malik down at the rail and Gentleman right up alongside. They're quickening the pace a little as they swing onto the backstretch. Bagshot is right there, just a length and a half back in the third spot, and now there's a gap of five back to Don't Blame Rio. Down the backstretch they go, and Gentleman now tilts his neck in front as they head to the half mile. Malik is trying to stick with him down at the rail. Those two still stride for stride as they run to the half mile pole. Bagshot has been a length and a half back throughout. He's quite happy to stay there, and there's still a gap of four back to Don't Blame Rio. Into the far turn they go, and Bagshot now has to pick it up on the outside. Malik down at the rail, and Gentleman, three of them in a line, five back to Don't Blame Rio. Coming to the quarter pole in the Santa Anita handicap. Bagshot on the outside. Malik down at the rail, and Gentleman between them. Pat Day gives Gentleman a little nudge on the shoulder to go on with it now. Gentleman is stopping. Something wrong with Gentleman. He's absolutely stopped. Malik and Bagshot go on. Malik in front. Bagshot up alongside. This is not the Gentleman we know. Obviously something wrong with him. And it's Malik and Bagshot. Malik is going to go on. Bagshot clinging to him. but it's going to be Malik and Alex Solis to win the Big Cap. Bagshot was second. Don't Blame Rio third. And Gentleman finished last.
For Alex, it's his first Big Cap win. For Richard, his second straight. Richard, the obvious question is, I know it's great to win two Big Caps, but not with a horse you probably expected.
Well, this horse, I've said all along, he's only run twice, and he showed very good. And he had an excuse in his last race. So I said, we don't know how good he is. My disgust and confusion is what was wrong with Gentleman, and I just don't know.
Anything apparent to you when he came back after the race?
He looked fine walking around there, but there's something wrong. We'll just have to find it.
And Malik came a pretty long way from winning the allowance race in December to winning the Big Cap in March. That's a big step up for a horse.
Yeah, but he's a class horse, and you can see it looking at him. His last race here, he ran a nice second, but he had a blood blister cut out of his foot that day, so he had a right to improve a lot.
How much can you enjoy this Big Cap win?
Well, I can still enjoy it.
Bleeding is a condition that affects most racehorses, regardless of class. Even Gentleman, the 1-20 favorite who finished last in the 1998 Santa Anita Handicap.
Technically known as exercise-induced pulmonary hemorrhage, the results of bleeding are physical, but the cause can be related in part to a horse's mental state.
Stress plays a very large part. Horses that you can get to relax usually bleed less. Horses will go out and exert themselves to their maximum, be under a stressful situation. Small vessels will break in the lungs. These vessels will bleed.
Excessive amounts of blood in the lungs inhibits the horse's ability to transfer oxygen into the bloodstream.
So basically, he's running on deoxygenated blood, which is the reason why horses hit five or six furlongs and then stop or back up, because they're not able to get enough oxygen in their blood. Even a small bit of blood that I diagnose with an endoscopic instrument after a race can make a difference in the horse's performance.
With 75 to 85% of racehorses bleeding to some extent, Lasix, a diuretic that lowers the horse's blood pressure, helps, but it's far from perfect.
Lasix is administered 4 hours pre-race intravenously, and it's 250 milligrams. I would think that it's absolutely effective in 50% of the horses at the most. It's going to help every horse somewhat, but if you have a bleeder that is what I would call a grade 3 or a grade 4 bleeder, even if you treat them heavily with Lasix before a work, they're still going to bleed through that.
But a horse's mental state plays a significant role as well.
A relaxed horse is a less stressed horse, is a horse that bleeds less.
Don't Blame Rio was just 3-32 lifetime going into the Big Cap, and he hasn't won a race in a couple of years, but that didn't stop trainer Doug Peterson from making what now looks like the genius move of the year.
Anything could happen in a race, so that's why I made the early nomination to not spend a lot of money. This horse, I knew he would run a mile and a quarter, and I knew he would run in the mud. So if something were to happen, I was going to keep him in the position. He had had a layoff. I had given him a race, had a chance to work him, and he was coming up to the race right as well. And things were falling into place, but I stayed very low-key. I didn't tell anybody I was running. I didn't want to give anybody else the idea. And by the time it was too late, either people had to supplement or there was nobody else eligible. I mean, he's a cut below, but on the right day, the right time, it's good to be there. He's probably one of the calmest, nicest, gentlest horses to be around. Every rider who's ridden him said this horse is such a professional. He goes to the post like a gentleman, never makes a mistake, and tries to do everything right. This horse, he tries so hard. He's done so well for us from a maiden 32 claimer. I mean, he's got a special part in my heart that he's had since we've taken him. I've never been around a horse like this that could be defeated. I mean, it took him, what, 12 tries to break his maiden and open maiden. He just ran into one good one after another, but he never got defeated. And most horses, you do that three or four times to them and they get discouraged. This horse always kept coming and always was there for you, and that's special to me.
With an honest try and a $120,000 check, Don't Blame Rio is laughing all the way to the bank.
The $1 million Santa Anita Handicap is now in the history books, and the $4 million Dubai World Cup lurks on the horizon as the next start for Kentucky Derby winner Silver Charm. Last week's Big Cap was supposed to be the match of the decade, but horses are, after all, only mortal. Gentleman had a bleeding problem during the race, and Silver Charm had a fleeting foot bruise that caused his connections to scratch him from the race.
I don't have any regrets because I didn't have a choice. The horse was not 100%. He was definitely off. And I really think that all these things happen for a reason. Maybe it wasn't meant to be.
Gentleman wasn't destined to run his race either. But yesterday, Silver Charm showed he's back in business.
I was really happy the way he worked. The track's been sort of dead. It's a pretty dry, sandy track, so it was nice at Sandita. They wired it for us and harrowed it before he worked. So it was a good work, though. He really had to work. He came back. He was puffing pretty good. So, but I needed to put something like that into him before I left, because when I get there, I don't think you can do a whole lot with them when you've been traveling that far. You know, they're going to be knocked out when they get there. So we're basically just doing our homework before we go. So when we get there, just bring them back fresh again and maybe breeze them one time there. But the way he looked today, he's right back on track. He didn't lose too much condition that I thought he might have. Now I feel more confident. I can put him on that plane tomorrow and know that when he gets there, I want him to represent not only us, but, you know, he's also representing the United States of America going to the World Cup. So we want to make sure he makes a good showing of it, whether, you know, he wins it or not.
The $4 million Dubai World Cup was indeed won by Silver Charm, the golden boy from Santa Anita, the star of America, and a world-class champion.
Well, if there was a Hall of Fame for game, hard-knocking, claiming horses, the 7-year-old Emua Kioki would definitely be worthy of first ballot consideration. A California bred with very obscure bloodlines, Emua Kioki has started 73 times with 15 wins, 18 seconds, and 7 thirds. He's been claimed 17 times, 4 of those times by a trainer who had him previously and has raced at distances from 5.5 furlongs up to a mile and 1/16. He posted career win number 15 last Sunday for trainer Ted West and was promptly claimed out of the race by Sandy Shulman. Emua Kioki never seems to mind a change of scenery, though, as he's won races for 7 different trainers.
Get involved today. They come for home, and Emua Kioki by 5. Mr. CI Prospector giving a game chase in second, but Emua Kioki has no intention of slowing down today. And it's going to be
Sandy acclaimed a 7-year-old gelding last Sunday, a real old-time hard-knocking horse named Emua Kioki. What'd you like about this guy to reach in and take him?
Well, I've always liked the horse. Many times I suggested it to Ron Charles at Clear Valley Stables, why don't we take him? And Ron really never really liked him that much, and I decided on Sunday, geez, that Ted West had just claimed him back. He obviously has had so many races, he's got to be halfway sound, and he's running good right now. So we put a ticket in for him, and he ran off and hit, as you well know, last Sunday, and probably will end up running maybe back this Sunday. There's a 16 in the book, and he came out of the race great, and just a nice old veteran to have.
And veteran he is. Emua Kioki's past performance chart is longer than the stretch at Fairplex Park, one of 10 different tracks he's raced at. With 16 trainers and 30 jockeys to his credit, this racehorse definitely knows where the wire is.
These old warriors, you know, you patch them together as good as you can and they'll run their hearts out for you. He's not perfectly sound and everything, but he just tries every single time. He's a little nervous horse, and I think that's part of the reason maybe why he's such a good horse, because he's so keen on racing. Anything, whenever he goes out to the track, he's feeling high, he trains intense and he runs intense.
Now, the horse like this, Sandy, a 7-year-old gelding, 73 lifetime starts, he pretty much knows what it's all about. What do you do to train a horse like this? You just pretty much put a saddle on him and send him out there?
No, you just absolutely. You just put him in the stall here and we'll jog him and gallop him a few days and then send him out to the races, right? He knows what it's all about. Each one of them are individuals, you well know, Kurt, and this is the easy part of training a horse like that.
Now, with a horse like this, when you run him back, chances are you're going to lose him right back again. Does that bother you?
No, not really. I mean, we probably could, as you say, you know, not lose him by running him for 20 or 25, and obviously you would put him a little out of his contentious level, and then, you know, you're really defeating the purpose of, you know, letting him win again or having a chance to win again. You know, this is the chance you take, and this is the business as it is.
And you're pretty happy with the claim so far?
Very much so, and I'll hopefully be a lot happier after Sunday either way.
For the 4-year-old filly series of 3 races, Fleet Lady captured 2, the La Cañada Stakes, and before that, the El Encino Stakes, when I Ain't Bluffin' was disqualified. I Ain't Bluffin' kicked off the series in the Grade 1 La Brea Stakes.
Minister's Melody, I Ain't Bluffing, digs deep and finds more. Praviana on the grandstand side, coming home late too. I Ain't Bluffing is just all hot, though Minister's Melody can't get by her. I Ain't Bluffing, the more they asked, the more she gave. And I Ain't Bluffing, an impressive winner of the La Brea from Minister's Melody.
Exotic Wood came into national prominence with her rivalry against Serena Song. As expected, the little butterball of a filly, as Jeff Siegel puts it, dominated most of this year's older fillies and mares division for trainer Ron Ellis.
Welcome to racing's version of the Last Dance. These ladies have been groomed, conditioned, and turned out for this very moment. The prize for the winner could be the chance to dance some more, while retirement probably awaits those outside the winner's circle when the music stops. The old lady in the ballroom, Track Gal, has twirled at nearly every waltz they've offered. Advancing Star longs to lead. When she gets her way, it's tough to stop her conga line. And Exotic Wood has tangoed her way to victory in four of her five contests over this dance floor. Who will be the belle of the ball? Santa Anita Today and Fox Sportsnet present the Grade One Santa Monica Handicap next. Exotic Wood is a daughter of the stallion Rahi. With that kind of pedigree, earnings of over $540,000, and a previous win in a Grade One race, most other mares of her age and class are already having foals of their own. But Exotic Wood's best days may not be behind her. Her long ears and powerful hindquarters have earned Exotic Wood the nickname of Jackrabbit. They have also earned her the nickname of Winner. The six-year-old mare is one of California's premier sprint stars, a reputation that was solidified with a fourth-place finish in her last start, the $1 Million Breeders' Cup Sprint against the boys.
Well, I was very impressed with her breeder's performance. I'm very proud of her. I mean, she gave it her all the way down to about the last 70 yards when she just finally got a little bit tired. And
her primary goal this year is yet another try at the Santa Monica Handicap. She finished second here 2 years ago in an epic battle with champion Serena Song. But this may be her final trip to the races, with the next stop being the breeding shed.
I don't make too much money when she's out making babies, so I'd rather have her in here running. You know, the barn, it's hard to replace those kind.
But there is still the Santa Monica left to run. Before she retires, this jackrabbit could hop into the winner's circle one last time.
Here comes Exotic Wood in the white cap on the outside to hit the front. Advancing Star tries to find more. Madame Pandit now looms the danger on the outside in third. It's Exotic Wood. Madame Pandit coming to chase her home in the center of the track. But Exotic Wood is playing too classy. And Exotic Wood is back in style under Chris McCarron as she wins the Santa Monica from Madame Pandit. Advancing Star was third.
Ron, I know you have to be very happy, very rewarding win. You got beaten this race 2 years back by Serena Song. You waited a long time, but you got the money today.
Yeah, well, you know, last year was very disappointing for us with this filly, and I'm just glad that she's kind of stepped back to the front of the class and shown what she was originally. You know, I don't think anybody ever thought this was going to be her last race. It was just a matter of how she ran, and she is six, but we enjoy her so much, and she had such a disappointing year last year. I have a feeling the Wygods will probably go on with her.
Coming to the 5/16, and Tuzla's had enough now. Tota Una Dama and Exotic Wood has pulled off the rail, and Exotic Wood now coming with her run on the outside. Exotic Wood coming fast. Tota Una Dama can't keep her off, and Exotic Wood off the rail wide in a brilliant burst of speed. And just look at the class of Exotic Wood here as she comes strolling through the lane, just exuding class. Chris McCarron just allowing her to trot down to the wire. The daughter of Rahi, Exotic Wood, turns it into a procession. Tota Una Dama second, then Tuxedo Junction.
Last spring, we watched as twin thoroughbred foals reveled in the green grass of nearby Rancho San Patricio. The darling duo stole our hearts and left us wondering how they would grow and develop. With the new year upon us, the twins have officially turned 1 year old. Yearlings that are strutting their stuff in unison.
The two cuddly colts, foaled in January by Kapellmeister out of Freya Stark, were a surprise arrival. After one foal was born, another leg came out and a second foal was discovered. In other words, no one knew she was pregnant with twins. Even more unusual was the fact that the twins were carried in separate placentas. Usually breeders will try to abort the smaller twin to allow one foal to grow big and strong. Since the twins went undetected, developed in separate placentas, and had the benefit of a big, strong mare, they were born healthy and nearly normal size.
You know, they've been together since they were born, and they have a great time. I mean, they're just like a couple of surfer dudes. You know, they're out there every day having fun, and they don't care about anything. They just go out and have a blast every day.
Let's face it, these boys have had it good for the past year. The only big event was weaning, which is typically a traumatic event in the life of a mare and a foal. But the twins had each other, and Mom was ready for a vacation.
When we weaned the babies, Freya Stark, she couldn't wait to get on the van. We just loaded her on the van, and she literally ran on the van to get rid of those two guys. She'd had enough, I think. Two was more than she bargained for.
Well, even though not much has happened in the past year as far as training goes, the colts have learned several important things. How to accelerate from a standing stop, as in the starting gate, how to handle a left-handed turn, as in the clubhouse or far turn, and how to pour it on when the competition is fierce.
It's a lot more enjoyable to have them than they're probably worth. I mean, we love coming out and watching them play. I mean, they're great. They're terrific entertainment, much better than television. No offense.
None taken. There's plenty ahead for the twins. In late summer, they'll be started under saddle in preparation for their arrival at Santa Anita next spring.
You know, be too crazy if they both got to the races on the same day.
And the twins, no doubt, will be camera savvy for the big day. Trackside, I'm Carolyn Conley.
All set for the Santa Margarita. And away they go. Praviana was off awkwardly. Fun All Over is coming out fast. Exotic Wood in the white, and there goes Traces of Gold up second. Exotic Wood going to settle down in third, being followed then by Fun All Over. Down at the rail comes Fleet Lady, in behind that Minister's Melody, Toda Una Dama, then Tuxedo Junction, nine lengths off the leaders, Praviana's second last, and Holly Ocala is at the back. They run past the 7/8 pole, and it's Fun in Excess setting the pace, leads it a length and a quarter. Traces of Gold second. They're slowing the pace right down up front here. Exotic Wood is racing in third, just three lengths off the leaders. Fun All Over is in fourth, and Fleet Lady on a tight hole, fifth, only four lengths off the leaders. Toda Una Dama is racing in sixth, and Minister's Melody in the white at the rail. Praviana is only six lengths off these leaders, then Holly Ocala, and Tuxedo Junction is last. They head to the half mile in the Santa Margarita, and it's Fun in Excess. Quicken them again now. Fun in Excess kicks on with it. Traces of Gold is in second. Exotic Wood right there third. At the rail is Fleet Lady, only four lengths off the leaders. Then comes Fun All Over, Toda Una Dama. Praviana is let loose now, and Praviana starts to make ground on the outside. And then comes Minister's Melody. Approaching the quarter pole, Fun in Excess, Traces of Gold, Exotic Wood now let loose, and here comes Exotic Wood in the white cap, and she's going right through them. Toda Una Dama on the outside with a big white face, running a good one. Traces of Gold did not go on. Fleet Lady, Praviana's battling past the eighth pole. Exotic Wood, Toda Una Dama, we down to two. Exotic Wood has to call on all her class. Toda Una Dama's making her run every inch of the way. Toda Una Dama, Exotic Wood, Toda Una Dama gets up. Exotic Wood was second, and Praviana finishes third.
Well, the often unsung hero of the sport of kings, a groom, is truly the hardest working individual in win, place, or show business. Let's go trackside with Carolyn Conley for more.
Far from the glamorous side of thoroughbred racing is the daily discipline of preparing horses for the races. And racehorses require special attention. Groom Ricardo Contreras knows the ropes. And in his 23 years of service to trainer Ron McAnally, he's handled some of the most valuable horses in racing.
But it is Passiano running away from them!
Although Contreras enjoys the excitement of winning big races, his reward comes in the close relationship he shares with the horses he cares for.
You can trust the horse and the horse trusts you. This is the best way you can work with the horses. When you come in the morning, you can see the horses, how he acts, how he feels, because you see how he acts every day. Sometimes he acts good, sometimes he acts like a little sick or a little sad. You know, you have to find out what's going on.
And due in part to his horsemanship, Ricardo has accompanied some of the world's greatest horses into the winner's circle.
I got Taispat, Vayacoa, Pasiana, Marat, and Northern Spur, Todo Nadama, Super Mormon. He got so many horses I can mention. I can remember.
Contreras has also shown a special knack with the fillies, winning the Santa Margarita 5 times with 2 seconds in the past 10 years.
When you go to the winner's circle, when you win the race, it's exciting. And sometimes, you know, you forget about it before what you think before after the race. Most of the time, to the horses, you know, the horses know you and you know the horses. And sometimes you go somewhere, like take a little break, and you think, well, what is the horse do now? You know, what are you thinking? Because he used to be see me almost every day in the morning and the afternoon, and then you go somewhere, and like the horses miss you, and you too miss the horses.
Ricardo Contreras knows the meaning of a job well done. He does it every day, and some special horses are counting on it.
The Derby buzz was on in the Colts division, with the main buzz coming from the 3Bs, Bob Baffert Barn. Even though his other colt, Real Quiet, was a non-winner in the Derby series, he did win the 98 Kentucky Derby and Preakness. Freehouse and Silver Charm raced down the stretch of last year's Santa Anita Derby as mirror images. Their rivalry continued throughout the Triple Crown. But while Silver Charm spent last weekend conquering the world in the Middle East, Freehouse was preparing to return to the track.
Hey, sweetie.
Yeah.
You have to go back to work, though.
Yeah.
You could have been in Saudi Arabia with your friends.
Freehouse and Silver Charm were supposed to resume their rivalry this winter at Santa Anita. But Freehouse has spent the last 4 months at his owner's SK Creek Farm in Bradbury.
He wasn't happy. He just wasn't, you know, as happy as Freehouse always is. And that's what was bothering Paco, because he knows the horse so well. And within a week here, he was fine. We might have had to push, and that's not our style. And I think once we made up our mind that we had to give him some time, you just forget that and you plan your life differently. So we're just waiting till the summertime.
To have a horse that good and be able to look out your front window and see him out in the paddock every day, I mean, it's pretty special. I don't think a lot of people get a chance to get that close to a horse.
I think mentally as well as physically, just get away from the schedule of the racetrack, the noise, the busyness of the racetrack. And just be a horse. Let them get dirty. Let them roll. Let them just, you know, do whatever it is they want to do.
One of the things Freehouse wants to do most is win races. He's the only horse to ever beat Silver Charm twice. It's a memory still fresh in his owner's mind.
It's a huge thrill when you win a Grade 1 race like that, especially a Derby, and especially the Santa Anita Derby, which is such a prestigious race. And this is a homebred, you know, and it makes it very special when you've raised him and bred him, and you still have his mother, and you've got his brothers and sisters coming along. So it was, I don't know, you can't describe moments like that. He's just a super intelligent horse, and he's got a personality like nothing I've ever seen. I mean, he's almost human.
Trainer Randy Bradshaw is a former assistant to Wayne Lucas and is now a great trainer in his own right. Artax is his golden boy, who won his second start by an impressive 9 lengths. 7 or 8 lengths.
His last race was 100 buyer figure, which, you know, for a two-year-old, and especially one that's slightly raced, is a pretty good number. My next option might be the Derby at Golden Gate, because it's Grade 3. It's a 1/16. I don't have to back him up in distance, because at this time of year, I want to move forward. I don't like to get high on young horses. I've never done that, because when I was with Wayne, you can be disappointed a lot by a horse that shows a lot early in the morning. This horse has been very, very precocious early in the mornings, and we've liked him all along. But just his last race, which showed that he could go 2 turns, and with development, it's going to be a lot better horse. I think we're looking down the road, maybe going to the Derby, and that's everybody's hope. And it's a little early, but I think he's a caliber horse to do that.
They turn for home in the Santa Catalina. Artax digs deep and finds more. Souvenir copies Weary in second, then Alan Zoop and Futuristic. But Artax has now put them away with a 16th of a mile to go. And from here on in, it's just a matter of how far Artax, super impressive under Chris McCarron, romps in the Santa Catalina.
In the battlefield that is thoroughbred racing, today's war is between a father and his son. The son, Craig DeLossie, served his boot camp training under his father's commands, welcoming returning warriors into the winner's circle. The father, Wally DeLossie, taught him with knowledge and love, preparing him for a racetrack confrontation he knew would one day come. That day is here, but they are not alone on the field of battle. The other soldiers are also seeking glory, and they include a well-respected veteran. To the victor goes the spoils, the chance to survive until racing's D-Day, Kentucky Derby Day. The battle is set to begin as Santa Anita Today and Fox Sportsnet present the San Rafael Stakes next. Wally DeLossie is a family man. He likes keeping things in the family. So when Prince Ahmed Salman went looking for a possible Kentucky Derby horse, his private trainer didn't have to look very far. He found what he was looking for in his own barn.
I wanted to continue to train the horse. I really liked this horse. And there were some other people that were interested in buying him. And I said, wow, if I'm going to be Prince Salman's trainer, I'm certainly going to tell him about it. And if he's doesn't turn out well, it's all my fault because I'm the one that suggested it to him. I just got a gut feeling he's going to run a good race.
But the horse to beat just might be Futuristic, one he used to train. And he's more than familiar with the colt's trainer. It's DeLossie's son, Craig. Today marks the first time the two DeLossies have ever met in a stakes race.
Well, his horse hasn't gone two turns yet, so he might be at a little disadvantage, but to beat him, I think he'd be proud of me.
Pride is one family value the DeLossies hold dear, regardless of today's race.
At the top of the lane in the San Rafael, Orville and Wilbur's Souvenir Copy coming to tackle him at the top of the lane. We come down to these two. Orville and Wilbur's digs deep. He finds more. Souvenir Copy giving a game chase, but Orville and Wilbur's has no intention of slowing down today. And Orville and Wilbur's in full flight for the wire. And it's Orville and Wilbur's and Corey Nakatani striding home to take the San Rafael impressively. Souvenir Copy.
It's a story the trainers want to keep real quiet, spending very little money and getting a very nice horse. It just doesn't happen. Well, seldom anyway, but that's exactly what happened at the Del Mar sale last year when Bob Baffert bought Real Quiet. It turns out Baffert is a huge fan of the sire Quiet American, so he purchased his bay son for owner Mike Pegram for the bargain basement price of just $17,000.
He was looking at the sales book and he saw the way the breeding and all that. He's out of a sister to full sister to Majestic Prince. And he said, you know, his first words were, what does he have, cancer? And so I said, no, he's just a little bit crooked, you know, turns out a little bit, a little narrow. And that's when we gave him the nickname the fish, because we explained to him that he looked like a tropical fish, because on the side, when you look in the fish tank, they look beautiful when they come at you. They're about that wide. So if you look at his front legs from the front, they look like they come out of the same hole. And they're just really narrow and stuff. So he's very aerodynamic. You know, when you watch him out there, you never know he was crooked. And he's straightened out a little bit. As they get older, when I bought Silver Charm, he towed out in both fronts a little bit. And now, you know, as older they get, a lot of them straighten out.
Last month's Hollywood Futurity win is proof that even with Real Quiet's physical oddities and small price, his ability does put him in the same league as his stablemates.
Most riders wouldn't dare dream about the career Kent DeSormo has had. The 27-year-old has won more races in a year than any other jockey, has won 3 Eclipse Awards as the nation's top rider, has 2 Breeders' Cup victories, and was the regular rider for a Horse of the Year. His trophy case is overflowing, but something is missing. Kent DeSormo has never won the Kentucky Derby.
There's a big hole. I was waiting for that Kentucky Derby trophy. It's the void. It's what's left. It's all that's left. Hopefully we'll be able to attain it.
He's had chances. From 6 derbies, he's managed to finish 3rd twice. But it's not those rides he remembers most. That honor belongs to Purdue King, the horse he finished 16th on 10 years ago. It was DeSormo's first derby.
I can still see the bars in front of my face, and I can hear the click when the doors open. I can remember the whole scene, the faded white paint underneath the door, the green color of the bars, and the crowd just going crazy. I don't think I know that it was the initial reason that I ever even dreamed of becoming a jockey. Sitting there that first Saturday in May and listening to the stretch calls and watching the Kentucky Derby field come down the lane and hear that, and down the stretch they come. It just raised the hairs all over my body, and I said, you know what? That's what I want to do. It's what I wake up for every day. It's the dream that I look forward to achieving, and hopefully one of those derbies in my career will have my name on it.
It is the quest of the dream that drove DeSormo to California 8 years ago. And while the dream is still beyond his reach, Horse of the Year Kodeshan made others come true.
The experience he gave me through a whole year, I don't think I would give up for one race. I'll be greedy and hope that I'll keep it and go along and get a Kentucky Derby.
After all, he's already reserved a space in his trophy case.
Artax finding more as he comes for home. Prosperous Bid on the inside, then Real Quiet. Sea of Secrets did not fire today. Homeward Bound now, and Artax is running a superb one. Real Quiet going to stretch him the last 16th of a mile. Artax has to call on all his class. Real Quiet is only a half back second. They run down to the wire, and Artax has won it ahead from Real Quiet.
He's a man, he's a myth, and he's an NXS cowbred named Indian Charlie. Three entities with the same name, and we're going to see if the youngest of them all can lead a charmed life and keep everyone in good spirits.
Part Native American himself, Ed Musselman, or Indian Charlie, gave a totem pole to his namesake, the colt with the look of eagles.
It's to keep them safe. Keep the demons away.
His two demons of last summer, sore shins and bone chips, were all gone in his first race back.
But he was a little bit rusty from the gate. He broke a step off or whatever, but he relaxed. You know, he didn't fight him or anything like that. And when he let him run, he just told him, you know, I don't want to get any big buyer ratings out of this race. I just do enough where he gets something out of it for the next race where he'll learn to relax and then turn it on. So came back. It was like taking a base on ball. So it was a good race. Really has three races because I worked him 10-1 from the gate one day, and that was his second race. So and he did it easy. He did not do it. You know, everybody said, what are you doing working that horse? Matter of fact, Ed Musselman, Indian Charlie, he was out here one day, and I was telling him the track's been dead. They need to tighten it up. I was complaining about it. And he said, well, this horse had worked 58. He worked 110-1. He said, if they tighten it anymore, this horse is going to leave the ground. It's unbelievable when you watch him work. He looks like he's just galloping. That's why Silver Charm looks, you know. So they had that in common, that huge stride that just runs, you know, horses into the ground. So
the spirit of Silver Charm lurks, but is Indian Charlie as laid back as last year's Derby winner?
Nobody's that laid back. Just me.
And there's another passenger on this Indian Charlie train, and it's our own Jeff Siegel. Jeff, more about Indian Charlie.
Okay, thanks, Kurt. You know, after watching Indian Charlie demolish the non-winners of Two Field last Sunday, I was wondering whether it was just too late in the season to seriously consider this colt as a legitimate Kentucky Derby candidate. Let's face it, Indian Charlie had just one sprint race at Del Mar last year before bucking his shin, so he has no foundation to lean on from last year. In addition, he kept getting sick this winter, so he missed even more valuable time. And if that weren't enough, consider that he's never been tried around two turns, and he's not really bred to run much farther than from here to that wall back there. So with the Kentucky Derby only about 60 days away, how in the heck can anybody consider Indian Charlie any kind of a Derby candidate? Well, call me an idiot, but I think he is. And you know why? Because the story already has been written once before.
1989 doesn't seem that long ago, but you may have forgotten the path that Sunday Silence took to the Kentucky Derby. Now, here was a horse that had been beaten in two of three outings as a two-year-old, with no starts in any stakes races and no tries around two turns. He didn't even make his first start of his three-year-old campaign until March. You talk about being behind the eight ball. And let's not forget, 1989 was the year of Easy Goer, the greatest horse since Eclipse himself, according to the guys in New York with the figures.
Go ahead, get out of here.
Well, despite the lack of foundation and the late start, Sunday Silence managed to parlay an allowance win in the mud to a victory in the San Felipe Handicap in mid-March, to a victory in the Santa Anita Derby in April, to a victory in the Kentucky Derby in May. Now that's a tall order for Indian Charlie to duplicate, and maybe it is asking too much. But there is one thing that Indian Charlie has going for him besides that silver-haired guy who trains him, and that is more natural ability than any horse in California and maybe the entire nation.
Exercise rider Larry D'Amore has ridden more miles on Derby horses than probably any jockey. On a daily basis, he's aboard the likes of Real Quiet and Indian Charlie, two of this year's top contenders. Now last year, of course, he galloped Kentucky Derby winner Silver Charm, and the year before, Larry started on his Derby roll when Cavaneer won the Santa Anita Derby.
That was really neat with Cavaneer a couple years ago. I wanted to win the Santa Anita Derby, probably more than the Kentucky Derby, because I never got the experience being at the Kentucky Derby.
Cavaneer went on to run second by a nose in the 96 Kentucky Derby, but last year was just the opposite. Larry's horse was runner-up in the Santa Anita Derby, then went to Kentucky for his Derby win. This year, Larry's hopes ride on Indian Charlie and Real Quiet.
Real Quiet's a little more focused, a little more aggressive right now, because he's a more mature horse right now, so he's got probably running on his mind a little bit more than Charlie. You know, I don't think he knows what's going on. He just runs because he can run, you know. I think it's just more of a natural thing right now to him, and he's just having fun. It's like if you had two kids and they were both running against each other, you wouldn't want to pick one to win. You just hope both of them run good.
Here's a few more tips from some more, and boy, do we need them, some real experts.
I wouldn't want to give a first choice because it's tough.
I like Real Quiet. I like Indian Charlie myself.
Going to be a dead heat.
Indian Charlie. Oval and Wilbur.
Indian Charlie.
Artex is my choice.
I like Artex in the Derby.
Real Quiet, Indian Charlie.
Indian Charlie.
It's all about national lore.
I think Artex is going to run another big one.
I like Artex.
Oh, I like Classic Cat.
I like Orville and Wilbur.
Artax and Indian Charlie to dead heat.
I'll go first, keeping the sculptor.
Artax. Artax.
I'd say Indian Charlie.
It's got to be Indian Charlie. It's a winner.
I like the horse that's in front of the wire.
Probably Artax, but Indian Charlie's doing good.
Artax. Yeah.
Yo, quiero Taco Bell.
Sent on their way, they all came away perfectly. Orville and Wilbur's two from the rail goes up to lead them early, with Indian Charlie at the rail showing good speed as well, and Artax nice and relaxed today. Artax in the black cap now running up third. Alongside of him is Skeeping, and then back to Classic Cat down at the rail. National Laws alongside of him, and Real Quiet trails the field early, but no more than five lengths from first to last. Past the 7/8 pole they go, and Cory Nakatani has Orville and Wilbur's winging out here. Orville and Wilbur's going fast. He's opened up by three. Indian Charlie quite content to track him second, and Chris McCarron and Artax are third. They now five lengths off that leader. Skeeping has to get a tap on the shoulder to keep up at the fast pace. Skeeping in fourth. Here's Real Quiet and Ken DeSormo in the red colors. They racing in fifth, six lengths off the leaders. Then Classic Cat and National Law is last, 10 off them. A half mile to run in the Santa Anita Derby, and Orville and Wilbur's continues to lead them by a length. Indian Charlie right there in second, and Indian Charlie now breathing down Orville and Wilbur's neck as they go into the turn, and Artax has a good spot third if he's good enough from there. Chris McCarron starting to ask Artax to respond now. Real Quiet is hard ridden but not doing enough. A quarter of a mile to go, and Indian Charlie hits the front and he looks strong. Indian Charlie opening up now to lead by two. Artax, Real Quiet trying to get involved late. Orville and Wilbur's can find no more. It's Indian Charlie in full flight for the wire. Real Quiet chasing him home. It's a 1-2 finish for Bob Baffert, but it's Indian Charlie and Gary Stevens too good in the Santa Anita Derby. Indian Charlie, Real Quiet second, Artax.
That was quite an accomplishment. I was pretty confident going into the race that we'd finish 1-2. I wasn't sure exactly what order, but I was very confident. Nothing phases him at all. I mean, they've got no qualms about shipping him or the crowd in Kentucky. I mean, he's just very professional.
The whoops and cheers were all for Indian Charlie, and well deserved. But a strong, silent type that also has rose-bearing potential is stable mate Real Quiet.
Real Quiet, he galloped out very strong, and he's run over Churchill before, and he was very unlucky there in November. He should have won the Brown and Williamson, which is the big two-year-old race in Kentucky at the end of the year. He had a lot of traffic trouble then. His style of running is going to, it's always going to mean that he's going to get into traffic trouble. But on race day, I think he's the horse. If I had to pick one to beat Indian Charlie, he's the one. I'm on a limb here.
Speaking of limbs, Indian Charlie's totem pole has flown the coop.
Yeah, you know what? That totem pole just had a bad feeling about it right from the start. Nothing really good was going on when that was there. And then Silver Charm, he just didn't make the big cap, and the totem pole was right there outside the stall, and I just had to do something about it. So I gave a guy $100 to take it off the track and dump it in a garbage can. So somebody in Van Nuys has probably got it in their front lawn right now, right up there besides the garden gnome.
One guy on his way to Kentucky with a Derby feather in his cap is Gary Stevens, who won the Santa Anita Derby aboard Indian Charlie. The win was Stevens' sixth Santa Anita Derby win, but the best part of his win was sharing it with his son.
TC is 13 years old and hasn't really taken an interest in thoroughbred horse racing throughout my career, and it's just been probably the last year and a half that he's figured out what his dad does, and he's really taken an interest in it. And he hadn't been to any of my big races, any Kentucky Derbies, any of them, and to come here that day and see the excitement, I think, in my eyes and the whole atmosphere of the Santa Anita Derby, and knowing what was coming next, the Kentucky Derby. I think he just got very, very emotional. I got emotional seeing the excitement in his eyes, and probably the most emotional moment that I've had in my career, having my son be so close to something that was so special to me.
The three-year-old Phillies division gave us two emerging Oaks champions. Hedonist had the most fun here at Santa Anita, and Keeper Hill went on to win the 98 Kentucky Oaks. Welcome to racing's version of the Winter Olympics. Today's event could be categorized as ladies' alpine skiing. Weather might be a factor with less than ideal conditions forecast for this gold medal event. Fitness and finesse will race side by side. Position in and out of the turns will be critical, with the winner being determined by just hundredths of a second. Several of these ladies will be racing over an unfamiliar course, and there isn't a defending champion. This isn't a qualifying heat, it's a grade one event, the equine equivalent of a gold medal run. Who will be on the victory platform? Let the games begin. Santa Anita Today and Fox Sports Net present the Las Virgenes Stakes next.
They come for home, Star of Broadway, Keeper Hill at the rail, and Career Collection now just not doing enough. It's Keeper Hill at the rail and Star of Broadway. Keeper Hill doing best with a 16th to go, and it's going to be Keeper Hill and David Flores to score in the Las Virgenes. Keeper Hill easy in the end, Star of Broadway.
Horse racing is more than a sport, it's a way of life. And for horsemen, it's a life that includes intensely personal moments. Moments that touch our hearts and teach us that the horse is a generous companion.
When we talk about horses being like our pets, it's further than that. They are our life, and it's what we live for. We get a very personal relationship, just eye-to-eye contact. We don't need them to speak to us in English or whatever other language. We can understand what they're saying just with a look.
Horses will even protect a person in trouble, like Howie, who maintained a straight course while his trainer dangled between the pony and a runoff horse.
Gave me time enough to get back into the saddle, get the horse pulled up, and if he had done anything but what he did, I would have been in the middle of those horses on the ground. Without question, I was in big trouble. But he did save my life, this son of a bitch did too. Look at him.
What's up there, boo-boo?
Yeah. Come on, son, come up, come up. Oh, Dad. Oh.
They don't intend to hurt you if they can help it, really. Only time a horse will hurt you when he has no other choice.
Horsemen risk injury every day working with horses, but it's a love affair that makes business a pleasure.
since I was a little kid, I always was around horses, and I feel very blessed to do something that I love.
If you're a true horseman, as most a lot of these fellows are, and ladies too, you can't hardly wait to get out here in the morning. We get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, and so the people that are out here are horse lovers as a rule.
Horse lovers that aren't afraid to show affection, displaying how important and appreciated the horses are, with a hug, a pat, or in the case of the 1997 Santa Anita Derby winner, a kiss.
Well, they always get one before and one after, regardless of what they do.
Horsemen share a bond with horses that dates back in history, a partnership based on trust, mutual appreciation, and respect, a love for horses. Trackside, I'm Carolyn Conlon.
Way to go. Keeper Hill stumbled at the start. Star of Broadway's out very fast, and Hedonist alongside. And Hedonist and Star of Broadway go up to lead them. Racing in third is Best Friend Stroh. Spiritual Magic on the outside of that. A gap of four back to Keeper Hill and Aki Verdi. And Nijinsky's Passion quite content to drop back last early is 10 lengths off the leader. Past the 7/8 they go, and Hedonist setting a good pace down at the rail. Star of Broadway. Now there goes Best Friend Stroh to keep the pressure on. Best Friend Stroh making Hedonist quicken up front. They're going fast again now. A close-up third is Spiritual Magic. Star of Broadway drops back to fourth, 3.5 off the leaders. Then a gap of five to Keeper Hill. Aki Verdi in the orange inside of her, and that still leaves Nijinsky's Passion last, 12 off the leaders. They have a half mile to go in the Santa Anita Oaks, and Hedonist is the leader by 3/4 of a length. Best Friend Stroh on the outside of her. Spiritual Magic in the pink, and Star of Broadway right there at the rail, fourth. Now Aki Verdi and Keeper Hill getting closer. They bunching up into the far turn. Even Nijinsky's Passion is only 6 off them now. 3/8 of a mile to go in the Oaks, and Hedonist the leader, being pressured by Best Friend Stroh. At the rail, Star of Broadway now looking for somewhere to run. Meanwhile, Keeper Hill comes with her run, and here's Keeper Hill in the blinkers on the grandstand side, and Nijinsky's Passion going to run another good one today. Nijinsky's Passion from last on the grandstand side. Hedonist at the rail, Keeper Hill between them. Star of Broadway, something wrong. She stopped to a walk. They run for home. Nijinsky's Passion and Hedonist. Hedonist at the rail. Nijinsky's Passion. Keeper Hill between them. Any one of three. Hedonist at the rail. Just going to get there. They run to the wire, and Hedonist has won it. Keeper Hill second ahead.
What a dream. I mean, you know, how can you even imagine this happening, you know? You think about it, but you don't think it can happen, and it's just been a very special weekend, and just got special people I trained for, and I'd like to thank my help, Carolyn. You know, you can't do this job if you don't have really good help, and I've got some of the best there is, so I'm just really tickled and couldn't be happier.
The open turf division was anybody's race as they queued up for the San Juan Capistrano, and trainer Neil Drysdale won 3 of 4 in the female turf series with Dance Parade and Fiji.
Oh, way to go.
My filly broke very, very cleanly and threw her ears up right away, telling me that she's very relaxed. And I thought that Kent's filly could be up giving me company, and he wasn't there the first several steps. I never saw him, so I felt that I was going to have things my own way throughout the race. And Kent, you can take it from here.
Well, she dwelt at the start, and everybody folded behind you. They were all looking to just leave you as the target, and I just swung out and said, well, we got to at least give them some, you know, some entertainment to get around this racetrack. Once I did swing her out, she pulled aggressively. I had in my mind at that time to sit behind you, but she was just way too aggressive. She finally relaxed here. She pitched her ears forward here.
My filly turning into the backside, she had come off the bridle. She was just kind of coasting along, eyeballing your filly, very comfortable at the pace that we were going. And I felt that I had a lot of horse underneath me. And as we approached the half mile pole right here, you went ahead and picked the pace up a little bit. And we were getting to a critical stage going into the turn where I either had to get up in there or let you drop over. And I was going to be forced to come around you. And I didn't want to lose my position.
Well, exactly. And once I pitched 3/4 on you down the backside, it had made it pretty tight. I thought I was going to give you the haze and get you out of there and establish the rail position. But as I got a little bit tight, or you got a little bit closer, and I figured, well, he's going to stay there as long as he wants. I'm just going to move out of the way and see if I can outrun you from there.
I think from the 3/8 pole, we both kind of had the same idea. When my filly didn't shy out of the tight squeeze going into the turn, that it was going to be a two-horse match race from the 3/8 pole. Let's sit on our horses and see what they can do the last quarter of a mile. And it was a great horse race.
Fiji and Kent DeSorbo, these two in a thriller. Nose and nose for the wire. Fiji on the outside, succeeds.
I stood up right there and asked you who got it. Neither one of us knew. Who won?
And I was like, I don't know. It's a head bible. I hate watching. You must love watching this race.
I mean,
I think the line's crooked.
And Fiji telling them, you're going to have to come and catch me. You want to win the Santa Barbara. Fiji's opened up on them now. Pomona in the red cap coming to chase her home in second. But it's Fiji in full flight for the wire. She's clear by four. Pomona is giving a game chase second. But Fiji, once again, just exuding class. Fiji in an overwhelming performance. Pomona second.
Words can't explain how nice she is. She just... It's hard to describe. She's a freak of nature. She can certainly get it done. She does it effortlessly, and I just have to thank, you know, the Prince brothers, because they're both involved with this filly, and Neil Drysdale for allowing me to have so much fun with his horses.
And Fiji suffered her only loss ever, just beaten a nose by 60 Saint. That was in her debut in America, but she was away slow.
Well, she completely dwelt the start. She absolutely just missed it, and I think I left too much in Sexy Saint's tank. I didn't pressure her earlier, but unfortunately, she had to settle for second, merely just missing the head bob. It wasn't from lack of effort. She doesn't know she got beat that day. I tell you that right now.
As individuals, they are virtually unequaled in the racing world. Four American Hall of Fame jockeys, four European riding champions. They have spent their entire careers riding for personal pride. They are solitary figures, entering the starting gate with the understanding their only teammate is the horse they sit upon. It is the two of them alone against all others. But not today, for on this day, they are members of a team, all trying to win, but all rooting for each other. At stake, the biggest prize of all, national pride. It's Team USA versus Team Europe as Santa Anita Today and Fox Sportsnet proudly present the International Jockey Challenge next. As for the participants, they are the elite of the racing establishment, the best the racing world has to offer. The four members of Team USA have combined to win 8 runnings of America's most prestigious race, the Kentucky Derby. The four members of Team Europe have combined to win 4 runnings of Europe's most prestigious race, the Prix de l'Arc de Triomphe. Jerry Bailey is the lone member of Team USA not based at Santa Anita. The 3-time Eclipse winner is the nation's current top jock by Money One. He won the 93 Breeders' Cup Classic with Arcong. Eddie Delahousse has been a Santa Anita fixture for the last 2 decades. This Louisiana native has totaled over $100 million in career earnings and has 5 Breeders' Cup wins. Lafitte Pincai is the elder statesman of the International Jockey Challenge. He has over $200 million in career earnings and is less than 300 wins shy of Shoemaker's all-time record. Gary Stevens is one of only 7 riders in history to win 3 or more Kentucky Derbies. He also has 4 Breeders' Cup wins, 5 Santa Anita Derby scores, and is the regular rider of Champion Silver Charm. Team USA is captained by Bill Shoemaker, who retired in 1990 as the world's winningest jockey with 8,833 wins. Shoemaker retired from training just last year. And representing Team Europe, Frankie Dettori rode at Santa Anita early in his career before becoming a European riding star. He won the 94 Breeders' Cup Mile with Barathea and won the Arc with Lamtara in 95. Kieran Fallon is the defending British riding champion. The Irish native won last year's English 1,000 Guineas and the English Oaks. He rode Borgia to finish second in the 97 Breeders' Cup Turf. Nick Kinane is making his first return to Santa Anita since riding Dance Design in last November's roughly run Yellow Ribbon. The Irishman recorded his biggest U.S. win in the 1990 Belmont Stakes. Olivier Pailliez has won Europe's most prestigious race for the last 2 years. Last year, he won a remarkably 11 races carrying Group 1 status, the most illustrious in racing. Team Europe is captained by Lester Piggott, an 11-time European champion jockey. Piggott retired from riding in 1985, but returned to the saddle in 1990 to win the Breeders' Cup Mile at Belmont. Jockey Eddie Delahousse has fond memories of his first International Jockey Challenge and what it means to him.
in 78, we had two or three races, and I won two of them. It did help my career get started and did make me decide whether to come here in New York, and I'm glad I came here. What's good, the people here in California will be able to see the European riders ride, and a lot of them, as you know, they're different styles, as we know. And we all want to win, and it's, America versus the British. So it's going to be a lot of fun, but it's pride, and it's if we get beat, well, we'll take it with our chins down. But I think we've got a great chance.
Late with Krahagen, and Eddie Dalla-Hussein from last with Blackwater on the grandstand side, and he's flying. Blackwater on the extreme outside. Mick Kinane, the Irishman, in there, and Tiburon and Olivia Pillay down at the rail of Blanket. Finish, they hit the wire, close!
What a way to kick off the competition. A photo there between Captain Collins and Blackwater. Captain Collins wins it from Michael Kinane. Eddie Dalla-Hussein second. Olivier Pellier third. Finishing fourth, Frankie Dettori, and Jerry Bailey was fifth. Team Europe takes the lead 15-6. Michael Kinane on top after one.
Now, can Frankie Dettori get through on Verreggio? One from the rail, and Sahara King and the Frenchman Olivier Pellier coming flying. Sahara King, Olivier Pellier going to mark up one for France here. Sahara King and Olivier Pellier win by two to goal distance.
Sahara King gets a perfect trip from just off the pace under jockey Olivier Pellier to win one for Team Europe. Jack Carava, the winning trainer, Team Europe takes the lead 28-14, and Pellier goes to the top of the standings with his first win ever in America.
I'm so very happy to ride for the championship, and now I, all the time I want to try the dirt in America, but I never ride, only on the turf, and I ride a lot in Japan on the dirt, but it's not the same, and I'm so very happy I win my first win in America.
But Frankie Dettori in the gold cap and Salo, and yes, Lafitte Pink Eye with one of those patented pink eye rides in the white blinkers. It's Nor'easter doing best of all, and Lafitte Pink Eye showing his class today as Nor'easter goes on to win it. Frankie Dettori.
A very popular win by Lafitte Pink Eye Jr. for Team USA. Nor'easter takes a triple jump in class off the claim for Bob Hess and gets the money. Team Europe now up by 6 points.
Yeah, on the outside is slightly speedy, and Frankie Dettori once again in the firing line, and Eddie Dalla-Hussein and Dom Bay explode! And Eddie Dalla-Hussein and Dom Bay looking like they just jumped in at the quarter pole. It's Dom Bay and Eddie Dalla-Hussein as the USA goes 1, 2, and 3. Dom Bay wins.
Amidst the cheers from the crowd, Eddie D from last to first aboard Dom Bay. Long shot rug under Lafitte Pincai Jr. Second, Team USA wins it behind Eddie Dalla-Hussein and Lafitte Pincai.
I also want to thank Shoemaker, Bill Shoemaker, for picking us two old boys, me and Lafitte Pincai.
That was very nice. I felt like I won another Kentucky Derby. That was a lot of fun. And like I said last night, that today was going to be a senior citizen day. And that's what happened today.
Last Saturday, jockey Lafitte Pincai Jr. reached a landmark in his quest to exceed Bill Shoemaker's record 8,833 wins. Pincai finished first aboard Closed Escrow for his 8,600th win.
I'm really proud of it, you know. To me, it's the greatest race in the world, and to be the champion over here, it made me feel really proud. I still got 200 and some wins to go, and I hope in the next 2 or 3 years I'll be very close, and hopefully I can break Shoemaker's record. It depends how many years I decide to ride. But things been pretty slow the last week. But I had some nice couple of good weeks in the past, and hopefully I can pick up some better mounts.
The elder statesman of California racing, Megan Zinnerko, could have been purchased for an $80,000 claiming price when he broke his maiden 7 years ago. And $1 million later, the gelding's not for sale and never will be.
Are you spoiled, Maggie? Are you spoiled? Just a tad. Hey, sweetie. He's everything to me. I mean, he's to me, he's human. He knows me and I know him well. And to me, he's just, you know, just the greatest horse to have in the barn. He's as happy as ever, and he's just the best thing that's ever happened to me as far as horses go. I think he put me on the map or you know, helped me a lot, and he's been with me every day since I started, never left the barn. But as long as he's happy and sound and is willing to perform and is eager to train, then we'll keep going with him. Right now, he's having a ball. He doesn't know anything else and doesn't know any better. And as long as he wants to do it, we'll continue. The minute he tells me he's not willing to go anymore, then we'll stop. I ideally would like to get on him at some point. I'm too scared of him now to do that, but ideally I'd love to have him as a pony, and I'd love to hang out with him in the morning. It'd be fun. I may end up on the ground sooner rather than later.
Stormtrooper in the green colors hits the front. Prize giving. Kesem Power. Amerika's in there too. Can Star Performance find a way through? Nowhere to go for Star Performance. Homeward bound, and Stormtrooper hits the front. Stormtrooper from Kesem Power. Kesem Power's coming gamely on the outside. Star Performance getting out late. They come to the wire. Kesem Power to get up. Kesem Power tags Stormtrooper. Star Performance had to settle for third.
I didn't want to run in the Sandless Ray because it was equal weights. That was my biggest battle there I had, because I felt like I should spot 10 pounds with most of the good horses in that race. So that was my big problem. But finally I said, I know he's a better mile and a half horse than a mile and an eighth horse. So I switched, you know, the last minute. I prayed and prayed and prayed about which race to run him in. It was such a tough thing for me, so everything worked out good.
I know, I came a long way here, so I was hoping to have a winner. But Mike said that the horse was in good shape, and everybody told me that the horse is a big trier. I listened to the trainer's instruction. They told me to wait till the furlong pole, and they told me there's a big button there to be pressed at the furlong pole if you can wait that long. And when I did press, it was so quick and great. I'm very pleased.
I think everybody got a kick out of seeing your flying dismount as well. I'm sure you've wanted to do it here for a long time.
That's what everybody's been asking me. Oh, but don't forget to fly dismount tomorrow as well. Let's win first.
Amerique finished a steady fourth in last month's San Luis Rey in spite of running five wide. But like most American horses, this colt has never run farther than a mile and a half.
He'd been running fairly good. He'd been right there, not getting beat very far, but you know, it's a mile and three quarters, and I think whoever has the most stamina is going to win.
Welcome to a glimpse of racing's golden past. Horses shipping in from around the world to test their mettle against a course where legends are made. The San Juan Capistrano is more than just an ordinary horse race. In a sport where the emphasis is shifting towards speed and sprints, this is one of the last remaining tests of true stamina. It is an endurance feat, equivalent to the 24 hours of Daytona, the Olympic marathon, or a 16-inning ball game. Who will be the king of the San Juan Hill? The riders are getting set as Santa Anita Today and Fox Sportsnet proudly present the Grade 1 San Juan Capistrano Invitational Handicap next.
The San Juan Capistrano is America's longest Grade 1 race, and it's a race that requires a strategy all its own, not only because of the distance, but due to the unique layout of Santa Anita's hillside turf course.
Well, it's a lot of fun, because it's a race that you really have to be patient. You have to be fit mentally and leg-wise, because you're going a long way.
You're trying to relax your horse as much as you can the first part of the race, and try for him to relax and not to get, he won't get ranked with you.
See, everybody's trying to get position, and hopefully everybody settles right into place before you get there, because if not, that's when trouble starts.
The hillside course offers twists and turns that many horses have never seen before. Combine that with crossing over the visually different main track, and an inexperienced horse can cause a rider to keep his feet on the dash.
I think that's a good way to put it. You keep your feet in the dash. You you stay braced. You're a little tense from the right to the left-hand turn. And once you get back onto when they get that rail again to follow, things seem to settle back down and the horse gets into a canter again.
You're not sure what your horse is going to do, even though you warm them up and cross the dirt while warming them up. It doesn't mean that they're going to cross it when they're running smoothly. A lot of times they'll jump it, and that can affect a horse's performance. So you have to really pay attention.
when you get to the backside, to the 5-8 ball, you really have to be looking now at what's going on, who you need to beat, and where you want to beat.
By the time you hit the 3-8 pole, I think all the strategy's out. That's when the race starts. The last 3-8 of a mile is going to be really all out, and that's what you want, a horse that has something left.
No other race in America offers the challenges of the San Juan Capistrano, a race unique to Santa Anita Park.
They're all set. Deal for the San Juan Capistranos, sent on their journey. Royal Strand is quickest into stride and takes the early lead. Star Performance in the red was out well, but doesn't want to go up there alongside of them. Now here comes Belgravia through at the rail, and Belgravia now the new leader. CC Ducteur is tugging pretty hard in the gold sleeves, and New Frontier in the white cap is in the vanguard as well, as now Star Performance contend to drop back into fifth. Devon Wood six, and then Amerique. We drop back to Ella Aristocrati, who's a good 14 off the Mataki's outside of that, and Kesem Power is last. Kesem Power's a good 20 lengths off the leaders. Coming down the hill, first time round now in the San Juan, and out on the lead here is Belgravia, leads it by just over a length to Royal Strand second. The pace is pretty decent for a race of this caliber. Back in third is CC Ducteur, and New Frontier is fourth. Down at the rail, Devon Wood is in the blinkers, and here's Star Performance in the red colors. Settled down in six now, he's five off the leaders. Amerique is racing all on his own, back fourth last, being followed by Ella Aristocrati. Itaki is second last, and Kesem Power is pretty keen to go on now. He's on a tight hold at the back of the pack. He's now only about 12 off the lead. Coming past the stands, first time round in the San Juan, and Royal Strand has now run up alongside of Belgravia. They slowed the pace way down here. Racing in the third spot is New Frontier, and CC Ducteur is right alongside of that. Devon Wood is only two lengths off them. Star Performance and Cory Nakatani quite content just to bowl along in the sixth spot. They're now four lengths off the leaders. Amerique is racing in seventh. Here's Ella Aristocrati back third last, but now only six lengths off the leaders. Kesem Power scrapes the paint second last, and the long shot Itaki brings up the rear. Down the backstretch they go in the San Juan, and it's still Belgravia at the rail and Royal Strand in the gold cap right there. CC Ducteur is coming to quicken matters now. CC Ducteur putting the pressure on the leaders. On the outside of him comes New Frontier. Devon Wood in the blinkers down at the rail. Star Performance going to have to sprint for home now. Kesem Power's getting closer to the leaders at the rail. Then it's Amerique. On the outside, Ella Aristocrati started his run caught wide, and then Itaki. They bunched up with 5:16 to go. Now it comes down to a matter of stamina. CC Ducteur goes on. Devon Wood in the white blinkers right there. Ella Aristocrati on the outside of that. Let's see. Star Performance is far, far back. Kesem Power's coming flying now. Homeward bound CC Ducteur alongside Amerique, Devon Wood, and Kesem Power, and Star Performance flying late. But Amerique has burst away, and it's going to be Amerique and Eddie Della Jose. Amerique wins the San Juan.
Ron, this is your second San Juan win, but it's been a while since the last one. That was back in 1980 with the great John Henry. Good to be back?
Yeah, good to be back, Kurt. After all, you know, we haven't run it that often. Mm-hmm. But anyway, I think you guys had more confidence in this horse than I had. Watching your show the other night, I give you a lot of credit. But he's bred to run the distance, and I told Carolyn this morning that that was the most important thing, to have a lot of endurance. You know, he's a nice colt, he's a good feeling horse, and he put it all together today.
Throughout the season, we've had the pleasure of bringing you some great moments, international competition, and thoroughbred racing at its very best. And as we bring you our final show for this season, we wanted to share some of our favorite memories with you.
Nowhere to go. Here's Lord Griot coming like an express train on the outside. They run down to the wire, and Lord Griot have won it ahead from an unlucky Silver John. Away they come. Sixie Saint and Gary Stevens at the rail. Fiji and Kent DeSorbo. These two in a thriller. Nose and nose. as she comes strong. They come for home, and now Gentleman has let loose and he explodes. And Gentleman looking like he just jumped in at the corner pole. And Silver Charm striding home in the Truth Stakes. He's saying, bring on Gentleman for the big cap. The race of the year is on the cards. Yes, let's see Pink Eye with one of those patented Pink Eye rides in the white blankets.
I feel like I won another Kentucky Derby. That was a lot of fun. Today was going to be a senior citizen day, and that's what happened today.
And it's Malik and Bagshot. Malik is going to go on. Bagshot clinging to him, but it's going to be Malik, and